coming to the last talk of the day on Start Lead. This is a very critical vulnerability recently disclosed, which is affecting Xilinx FPGA chips that are commonly and widely used in a lot of data centers and IoT devices. The speaker for the day is Mike, who is the co-author of this research with Christoph Parr and his team. So Mike, the floor is all yours.
Yeah, thank you for the introduction. I'm talking today about breaking FPGA encryptions using FPGA encryptions. Or let's say I'm talking about Starbleed, so the full break of the Bitstream encryption engine of the Xilinx 7 series FPGAs. Yeah, I'm Mike Ender, and I'm a PhD student from Amir Moradi and Christoph Parr from the Ruhr University and the recently founded Max Planck Institute for Security and Privacy. And as I look on my desk, I'm working with FPGAs, and I have here an FPGA board lying around. And actually on the middle of this board, there's the field programmable gate array, so this FPGA. And it is kind of an special IC, so it has a reprogrammable logic, as the name says. And every time I switch the FPGA on, I have to load the design onto this FPGA. And therefore, I use the so-called bitstream. And this bitstream is stored on an external memory and contains the design. So as this chip is reprogrammable, it determines its function after manufacturing. And so this device can anything becomes you, any digital circuit becomes you want. So it is used in a variety of fields. So for example, telecommunications, industrial control systems, aerospace, or in the military field. And I think you guys as the industry guys know better where they are all used. And as this bitstream contains the design, it is interested from an attacker's point of view. So as it is also stored on an external memory, we can kind of do fiddle around with this. And if we can look inside the design, we can clone the design. So we can take the design from one board to another board. Or we can reverse engineer the design, so we can get all the intellectual property out, or algorithms, or so on. And as it is stored on an external memory and we can manipulate this external memory, we can also manipulate the design. So design manipulations are possible, and even implanting hardware trojans is possible. So the security of the bitstream is kind of vital. And therefore, all bitstream or all FPGA vendors invented the bitstream encryption. So they lock down the bitstream so that it is encrypted, and then during the loading of the bitstream, the FPGA decrypts the encrypted bitstream, and then runs the design. On the Xilinx 7 series, there are two key registers, so you can use it in fuses or in a battery-backed RAM. And this bitstream encryption engine should first ensure confidentiality, so that the bitstream is encrypted and no one can look inside. So the attacker is all the content is hidden to the adversary. And on this Xilinx 7 series, what we are talking about, there is an AES used to ensure this confidentiality. And also, the bitstream encryption should ensure authenticity and integrity so that we cannot change the design, so that we cannot implant hardware trojans, for example. And therefore, an HMAC is used to ensure this this integrity and authenticity. So now coming to our tech, and what we are doing is on a big picture, we manipulate this encrypted bitstream, and with this encryption, we kind of change some commands inside to then ask the FPGA to decrypt us the bitstream. And the FPGA uses its crypto engine to decrypt the content of the bitstream and then sends it back to us. So we use the crypto engine from the FPGA to break it, to use this FPGA encryption engine to break the FPGA encryption engine. And we got the decrypted bitstream out of the FPGA. And our attack is kind of two-folded. So in our first attack, we break this authenticity. So we break kind of this AES, or the implementation of the AES actually, right? And in a second attack, we broke the authenticity. But first, we have to look on what is going on here with this loading process. So first, let us look on the how to program an FPGA. So here we have our FPGA, and all the magic in the FPGA happens in the so-called fabric. So the fabric, there is the reprogrammable part. There all the design is running. So this is kind of the of interest for the designer. And as the design is lying in the bitstream, we have to get the design in the bitstream to the fabric. And therefore we have a configuration engine. And an configuration interface, so like JTAG or the select map interface. And we're talking to this configuration inside the FPGA. So this is kind of an abstract model here. And as the bitstream itself, when you look here, is organized in words and commands. So you issue commands to this configuration engine, and basically you program configuration registers inside this FPGA. And there are a bunch of registers, so there are around 20 documented registers, which you can read and sometimes write from. Rewrite from it and sometimes read from it. And as we are in the crypto domain, we need a decryption engine for the encrypted bitstream, and we place it before this configuration engine so that we can switch this engine on or off so that we have an not encrypted bitstream or an encrypted bitstream, as both are possible. And when we again look at the bitstream, we have here an encrypted bitstream. And the bitstream kind of need to say to the FPGA that it is actually an encrypted bitstream. So it has an unencrypted header where it actually says, yeah, I'm an encrypted bitstream. So please start the encryption engine, and then all the encrypted bitstream starts. And as we are kind of on the attacker's view here, let's take a sneaky look inside. And all this green part here is encrypted. So we as an attacker can't see inside, but the decryption engine here on the FPGA decrypts it. So the configuration engine sees this decrypted bitstream. And it is again organized in words. And just let us configure this bitstream. So we issue this bitstream to the FPGA and see what happens. So at first the decryption engine is turned off and the bitstream starts. So we send the header to the configuration engine. And then right at the beginning, the first command is to start this decryption engine. So the decryption engine here is now turned on. And then one of the next words right in the bitstream, in the encrypted part of the bitstream, an HMAC header is passed to the configuration engine. And here you see it's going through this decryption engine. So it's actually decrypted now. And then processed in this configuration engine. Then one of the next commands is to write to the control register. So the next word is written to the control register, configuring something on the FPGA. And then one of the next words is to write to this FTRI register. So actually writing to the fabric. So the next words from the bitstream is written to the fabric. And so we configure this fabric, and so we configure the FPGA. So this is the part of the design. So this is the biggest part of the bitstream. These are the megabytes of the bitstream. And to finish the bitstream, the HMAC tag is passed to the FPGA, and the FPGA validates this HMAC tag, and so validates the bitstream. And if everything is okay, the FPGA just runs your design. Okay. So now how we can break this confidentiality of the bitstream. And therefore we, as an attacker, go here and change this write to the FDRI register and change it to writing to this WB star register. And we can do so by exploiting the CBC malleability. Well, this is kind of a standard attack. And just by XORing a delta to the bitstream, to the encrypted bitstream, as we know the plaintext and the position of this writing to the FDRI register command. And of course, the HMAC got invalid by this, but this won't happen. This won't hinder the attack. Okay, so now we can issue the manipulated bitstream to the FPGA. So we start again with the header, start with the start decryption command. So the decryption engine is now turned on, and our manipulated bitstream got decrypted by the FPGA itself. So the HMAC header passes, the write to the control register passes. This is not the manipulated part. And now our manipulated word comes into place. And is now not writing to the FDRI register, but writing to the WB star register. So now the content, which should be written to the fabric, is now diverted to the WB star register. And now here in the WB star register is the unencrypted part from the fabric. So this is now unencrypted data, which should be encrypted on the bitstream. And to not write more words to this register, we cut the bitstream. We simply cut it. And we of course have to still send the HMAC tag. Well, of course the configuration is kind of this designed, but this HMAC tag is invalid. So the FPGA notices it and says, there's something wrong with the encryption engine. So I have to reset. But now here the magic comes. And therefore let's take a look inside the documentation, and I will read the important part here. When a fallback happens, so when the decryption engine notices this manipulation from the HMAC, then an internally generated pulse resets the entire configuration logic, except for the dedicated multi-boot logic. So the warm boot start address register, this WB star register, is not resetted, as the multi-boot feature is used to switching between images of the bitstream on the fly. So you can use multiple bitstreams to switch between, to have an update feature also. And this warm boot address start register is used as an address register. Okay, so now we are on our state. So we have the content from the fabric diverted to this WB star register, and now the FPGA resets. So everything is cleared except the WB star register. So we have now the decrypted content in the WB star register and a resetted FPGA. And then we can use a readout bitstream to read out this configuration register. And this readout bitstream is fairly simple. You have a header and then read the WB star register command. So the FPGA then put out the bitstream, and so the decrypted bitstream. So we used here the decryption engine from the FPGA to decrypt us the content of the encrypted bitstream, and then leaking out the decrypted bitstream via this WB star register. Okay, just to sum it up a bit, first, we have to manipulate the bitstream, so to change this write to the WB star register command. Then we, of course, need to configure this bitstream, this malicious bitstream to the FPGA. The FPGA notices that the HMAC tag is flawed and resets automatically. But we can then use the second readout bitstream and read out the WB star register. And lastly, we reset the FPGA again so that we can repeat this process. Because with this process, we leak 32 bits. And so we have to repeat this process to leak all the bitstream words from the encrypted bitstream. And for one word, we need for, on our device, the Kintex 160, around 7.9 milliseconds per word, so around 3 hours, 42 minutes for the complete bitstream to leak it outside. But I think there's, of course, still room for improvement. And even for the biggest Vertex 7, 1140, we need roughly a day to leak out the bitstream. Okay, so with our first attack, we broke the confidentiality. So the attacker can decrypt now the bitstream. And with these bitstream security is kind of vital, we now can clone the design, as we can look inside, and we can reverse engineer the design. But we still can't manipulate the design as we still have the HMAC in place to ensure the authenticity. And this leads us to our second attack to break the authenticity. And there we know that with the first attack, we can decrypt the bitstream, so we can look inside. But the HMAC is, still assures the authenticity, and any manipulation would be detected. But now here comes the trick again. And this HMAC header here in the start of the encrypted bitstream holds the HMAC key. So we can get out the HMAC key from the encrypted bitstream. And as we then have the HMAC key, we can forge new valid HMAC tags. So we can now kind of overcome the HMAC. But still, we need to re-encrypt as this bitstream is encrypted. So we use there again the first attack. So we use it as an oracle, as an decryption oracle. And using a CVC decryption oracle with the CVC malleability, we can build an encryption oracle. And this is kind of a new known attack since years. So from Rizzo and Duong, they showed this on the Wood workshop 10 years ago. So we use this decryption oracle, the CVC malleability, to build an encryption oracle and to use the HMAC key. So we can now forge new valid HMAC tags. And so we can now build our own bitstream, which is completely valid. So we also broke the authenticity of the FPGA's bitstream encryption, and thus we can now manipulate the design, so also implant hardware trojans. So we fully broke the FPGA's bitstream encryptions on the 7 series. But what was the root causes for these attacks? So what went wrong? And the first root cause here is use before validate. So this enables the first attack, as here the commands interpreted by this configuration engine are validated after they are interpreted. So the standard use before validate kind of flaw here. And the second attack was possible as the HMAC key was stored inside the encrypted bitstream. So the attacker can now forge valid HMAC tags. And these are the two root causes kind of. So what can we do about this attack? So what are the general countermeasures and defense techniques? And we discuss 6 different techniques and countermeasures, and they are differently applicable to the new series, so the UltraScale Plus series or UltraScale series, and also for the current series and for completely new developments, of course. So the kind of obvious countermeasure is to validate the bitstream before interpreting it by the configuration end. And this is done on the newer series. So there's this RSA RSA signatures, which ensures this validation before they are interpreted. And it's kind of a bit ironic to have a reprogrammable device, but not a reprogrammable bitstream encryption engine. So this would be kind of nice to have this. And again, this is also possible in the new series with this RSA signatures. And also now for completely new developments, this would be nice. And in a more general way, now we have the general defense techniques. So as the attack is already visible in the documentation, so we can already see it in the documentation. We kind of found it also by looking in the documentation. And so the specification is flawed. Now there's kind of some trend to formally verify all your hardware and also then formally verify the specification. We had this kind, I think, in talks before here today. So to use these model checkers or information flow analysis so that no confidential data is leaked out on any way. So using this WBSTAR register, for example. Also, we can maybe use open source hardware. So for example, the Open Titan project so that the community can ensure this, the specification is not flawed, use these model checkers or information flow analysis and have a community built around. Of course, there's a discussion if open source really helps security, but yeah, it can be a good starting point, of course. And what can we do with the current devices? Sadly, there are no real countermeasures, but they are raise the bar countermeasures. So it's kind of a patch to these devices. And first, we came up with obfuscation. We have our design and then tangle around. So we tangle the design around, have still the same functionality, but for an attacker, it's harder to reverse engineer this design. And also one can build some loading engines with it so that we can encrypt different bit streams. And so this is also possible to bound an obfuscated design to a specific device. But also this is only makes it harder for the attacker. So this is only erase the bar countermeasure and patches kind of this this vulnerability. Not really, but it makes it harder for the attacker. So it's erase the bar countermeasure. And the next countermeasure for current devices is the revision select pin countermeasure. And here credits to our anonymous reviewers. They came up with this cool idea. And when you look at the WBSTAR register, the upper two bits are linked to the revision select pins. And these two bits drive actually output pins on the FPGA. So you can control this revision select pins with the WBSTAR register. And normally there is zero in these in this register, but during the attack, this register is not zero anymore. So maybe there are ones on the revision select pins. So we can drive IO pins on the FPGA. And this we can use to build a countermeasure. So we have our FPGA in place. We have the WBSTAR register, we have the crypto engine, and we use here the battery-backed RAM for this crypto engine here. So not eFuses. Why you see in a minute. And the FPGA is normally placed on the PCB and you connect it to the power rails on the PCB, and as the battery backed RAM is, as the name says, it's battery backed, so a battery powers the battery backed RAM key storage. And we can use this as our advantage as we remove the power from this battery-backed RAM key module, the key got cleared. So what we can do is to wire the WB star register to a reset logic so that if the attack happens and these revision select pins are one, the reset logic see that, and then we connect the reset logic also to the power rails of the battery backed RAM module and the VCC power lines. And if this attack happens, the WB star register is not one anymore, so the reset logic get this, and then it removes the power from the battery backed RAM module and the VCC line of the FPGA. So the FPGA got reset and the battery backed RAM module got cleared. So the key is vanished, it's not there anymore, and the attack is stopped. And the key doesn't come back because it's cleared. So you kind of break the device, of course, but the attack is then stopped and you cannot rerun it on this FPGA. But still, this is only a raise the bar countermeasure as we, as an attacker can, for example, cut this line here. So this brings the attacker to the PCB. So there's the PCB security problems, of course. Okay, so let me conclude my talk. And what we did, we broke the confidentiality and the authenticity. So with breaking the confidentiality, we can decrypt the bitstream. And with breaking the authenticity, we can manipulate the bitstream. And therefore, we fully break the confidentiality and authenticity. So we fully break the FPGA's bitstream encryption using the FPGA's bitstream encryption. And therefore, we only need access to the configuration interface. So either the JTAG or the select map interface we need for this attack. And now we affected with this attack the Xilinx 7 series and partially the Vertex 6 series. And for these devices, there's only raise the bar countermeasures as we have the revision select pins and obfuscation, of course. And more general defense techniques would be to verify the specification as we have already the problems in the documentation. We can see it there. And of course, open source hardware might be an option. So yeah, thank you very much for listening, and maybe following me on Twitter, or you can read our paper, which is online on the USENIX homepage. Yeah, and so I hope you have questions.
Thank you, Mike. I believe you must have received questions in your chat window.
Yeah, I search for the chat window because it's, there it is. The question here is how to manipulate the bitstream when it's encrypted. So how can we kind of issue this CVC malleability? And let's go to a slide here. Just ignore this part, but here on this picture, this is the CVC block chaining mode. So you have an initialization vector. And this is the decryption mode. So we have the ciphertext. The ciphertext got decrypted and got chained to the block before. So if you have here a plain text, you chain it to the ciphertext from the block before. And now if we look here in the plain text, this is all XORed. So when we XOR here something, we XOR here a delta to this ciphertext, we also, of course, this plain text here become garbage. As we change only one bit, this plain text changes. But when we have this XOR here, this delta also comes here. So we can manipulate this plain text. As we know the position of this writing to the WB star register command, and then we can change this command. And the garbage here from the block before, we luckily used this HMAC header. So we changed the HMAC header, so we kind of changed the HMAC key, but changing the HMAC key doesn't do anything, as the HMAC tag is already invalid. So changing the HMAC doesn't, HMAC key doesn't make any changes to our attack. And this we can kind of change here the bitstream this way we can manipulate the encrypted bitstream. Okay. So there's the chat. Does clearing the BB RAM allow the chip to be reused? I think so, as you can, of course, then use the chip again, but the BB RAM is cleared. So the BB RAM is cleared, but you still can use the device. And you can reload key again to this device. This is possible, but putting it in a freezer, I'm not sure how this clearing process works. This should be, of course, tested. So how is the key shared with the FPGA? The key is generated on the designer's computer. The key is generated, and then the key is put on the device via the JTAG interface. So you have to have the JTAG interface in place, and then can load the key via the JTAG interface. And this you have to do during the building of the of your project, of course. There is this loading process of the key. How to compare to Xilinx's statement, since the part is vulnerable to DPA attacks, this attack does not increase the risk of compromise. This kind of depends on the attacker model you have. Of course, we only need access to the configuration registers. So we only need access to the JTAG or select map interface. And during a DPA attack, you also need to do your measurements. So you also need to measure the power rails, for example, and have therefore equipment and knowledge and experience with all these equipments. So you need a more advanced attacker therefore. But of course it's depending on your attacker model. And if you don't allow physical access or access to the command, to the JTAG or select map interface, then it's kind of on the same stage. Of course our attack is obviously kind of easier in terms of the needs for the attacker, what the attacker needs. The electronic, can you comment on the photon emission electronic optical probing attacks to read the key in the BB RAM? This of course would make the attack easier, but again, you need to have an electronic photo emission and electronic optical probing equipment and so on. But this, of course, would make the attack more easy when you have the key. So with our attack, we don't leak the key, but with these DPA attacks and optical probing attacks, you leak the key. But I'm not sure there is a paper out with these voltage probing, I guess, and they also leak only the decrypted bitstream, so they also don't leak the key, I guess. But of course, it's we only need the access to the configuration interface here. Introducing the VB star command in the encrypted payload will result in a different plain text, isn't it? Yeah, of course. When we change the VB star command right here, or when we this is what we want, right? I hope I get your question right. But when we change here the WB star command to this is what we want, so that we can change here the WB star command to divert from the fabric to this register. So the plain text is changed, and this is what we want. So we want to change the plain text. So we want to change this command here. So this command is changed. On Altera FPGAs, we don't know, so we don't look there. But yeah, of course, the thing is that it's always kind of hard to defend a device, and it's kind of easy to break it. So we don't know if there's anything in. I think there is also the side channel attacks on these devices. But not these kind of these attacks here. Yeah, obfuscation techniques, there are a bunch of out there, I think. And I think there are a lot of obfuscation techniques, and I think there's still room for improvement on these obfuscation techniques. So some colleagues of mine researching actually on this, and they try to build some obfuscation techniques, and it's kind of hard, so that it's not easy for a computer to break this obfuscation technique and then to break it for a human. So you have a obfuscation technique which should be hard for both of them. So this is kind of hard, and there are a lot of out there. And I think there is still room for improvement on these. Okay. I hope I got all questions. Feel free to ask more.